Hello friends, welcome back on Desi Plaza TV. I'm your host Kushbu Rawley with Dr. Prakash Rao Velgapudi over here. And it's about the book, Reviving Hinduism is the topic of the day. So Mr. Prakash Rao, welcome back. And after having discussed all the importance and the benefits of Hinduism and how it's a scientific religion, how it's inclusive religion, I would like to ask you, what intrigued you to write this book? And you've also mentioned the need, as in these times, even it's more to actually preserve it, to actually protect it, and if, you know, as a Hindu, stand for it. So what made you do that, and why do you think it's needed now, and what are the threats that Hinduism is facing?
Yeah, you know, we briefly talked about what is the richness of the glorification of Hinduism, what are the good points. Now I see that there are many, many dangers or challenges Hinduism is facing at this time, especially since independence, even though it faced before also. I think since independence, probably we are facing more problems than before because of the government that is involved in many, many different things. So I'll just briefly talk about few things. First of all, since independence, almost all the temples are taken over by the government. That is one thing. That means basically they are going to run the show. In a sense, they control the money, they control the pujas, they control the land distribution. Almost anything about the Hindu temples, the government has taken over. And as a result,
Endowment Act is different than this.
Yes, Endowment Act. But that does not apply to Christians or Muslims. They can run their churches and mosques independently without government interference, but it is only Hindus, the Hindu temples, that are under government control. That is one challenge.
If it was a religious institutions, I guess all the religious institutions should fall under the same rule. So,
for any reasonable, any logical person, any scientific person, that is true. When governments are not logical, when governments have their own biases, when governments are interested in trying to get elected in order to build up this vote bank politics, they go to any extent to destroy the culture which really made them so powerful in the country. So basically, these are the people who are destroying their own culture in order to get elected, in order to make money. That is the major problem that we face in India. That is one problem. And then we say, I think you probably read one of the chapters, Intolerant Intellectuals is one of the chapters that I had written. And these are the people, we have a group of people in India, so who actually are sold to other religions, either because of the monetary benefits or other benefits, and they always side only on the minority side. So the government has given so many privileges to minorities, it is almost unbelievable. No other country will ever consider doing any of the things our government has done to the minorities. For example, if you look at the Muslims, there is a separate quota for all the Muslims in the occupation, in the educational system, in the employment system, in everything. At the same time, they also set aside crores and crores of money for Hajj subsidy. That means they allow Muslims to go to Mecca in order to witness the, to experience the Mecca according to them. Mm-hmm. So for now, that is happening since 1960, okay? Whereas when you compare that one with Hindus, they basically, they are paying more in order to travel to religious places, especially on Shivratri night. So the government charges more money only on that day. They charge money and then get more money.
And it's unfair.
And then for Muslims, they have created Hajj houses and Hajj terminals. And then you have the air-conditioned buildings in the airports itself so that all the Muslim pilgrims going to Mecca will be able to stay in those air-conditioned houses. Whereas if you look at Sabarimalai, which is in Kerala, so 40 days, many people trek almost about 20 miles, 30 miles, and they sleep like beasts on the streets. Whereas all the Muslims, they stay in air-conditioned houses, they are given all kinds of privileges, and no government would even think of doing something similar to Hindus, even though they are supposed to be 80% of the population. So in order to please the minorities, they are basically destroying the backbone of the Hindu population. And as a Hindu population, we are not able to even convince the government to see how we can bring the parity between them. So not only that one, these intellectuals, the so-called intellectuals, only when there is some problem against Muslims, they will just cry, and then with all the loudspeakers, they will go out and demonstrate and all that. But they never say one word about any Hindu being killed by other religions. I think about 2 years ago, Dadri case, it happened. Some Muslim was killed by a Hindu, according to all the things. And then at that time, they mentioned about 4 churches were attacked in New Delhi. And so they demonstrated and they surrendered their awards and everything else, the prizes they got. But what they have done, they refused to acknowledge there are 360 temples were attacked at the same time in Delhi itself compared to 4 churches, but they never mentioned one word about 360 temples being attacked. So they have dramatized.
I think that's the role of and responsibility of media, which should also be fair.
So the next enemy is media. So this enemy is, it is basically, if you look at, scientifically, I think all of us have to look at how this media is being supported by and who is supporting them. If you look at it, there are many, many Christian organizations, many Muslim organizations, many communist organizations who are supporting the media. So that's the reason you don't see any media actually even trying to be fair. You know, it's not that we have to be Hindu-oriented kind of thing. But is it logical? Is it reasonable? Can we be fair with all the news that are happening? It never happens
that
way.
Which is the first responsibility of media.
Exactly.
And even government, to be fair and provide equal benefits to all their citizens.
They are supposed to be fair, they balance, and you try to give both points of view. And that is basically a fair request, but it never happens. So only when somebody, I'm just going to give you about one example where some gentleman has written a letter in Wall Street Journal, where he says that, there are many Hindutva vigilantes are killing so many people, and he described it. Numerous incidents have happened ever since Modi came and all that. But if you look at it, there are probably about 6 to 8 incidents may have happened in the last 2 years. But this gentleman has written in such a way as if the whole country is being just, all the Muslims and other are being massacred by the Hindus and all that. So that is the impression that he wanted to give. That is how he was describing the whole situation.
I guess Hinduism is a peaceful religion, but at the same time, when it comes to protection and in the situations, everybody should be really fair, especially government as well as media.
Yeah, exactly. So that is another thing. Now, if you look at some of the practices of other religions. So especially there is a chapter which you probably read that one, Christian deceptive practices. So they are making inroads into the villages by deceptive practices. So you can ask, what do you mean by deceptive practices? Do you have any proof? Can you show some of the examples? So we can always show a lot of examples. First of all, if you look at Hindu temples, you have all the Indianization and all that. So now they are building their churches exactly the same way we build the temples with the Rajagopuram in the front. Instead of having the kalshas on the top of the Rajagopuram, they have the cross. And also, so they also do arati, just like the way we do it. And also they developed Sahasranama, Astotranama in Sanskrit. So that means 100 names for Jesus and 1,000 names for Jesus also. And then, so they also put Jesus Christ in the chariot, the way we put Lord Krishna, you know, in front of all the churches, okay? And they also put Bindi. So these are all the things they're doing in order to attract as many Hindus as possible, and then they will try to woo these people so that they can come and then convert them.
I guess if all the religions have something to offer, and if it's okay to take something good from anything, I guess we should all learn and grow from each other. But then might as well live and let live, yeah, rather than trying to convert. And I guess that applies to both sides, everybody, you know, it applies to everybody. And Hinduism, which is known, India, which is known as a land of ahimsa, I guess we practice it already. And that's what I guess you're trying to say, that everybody needs to actually revert back with similar sentiments, and that's the way to live together in these times.
Yes. Yeah. I mean, we always, as you mentioned, we always believed in live, let live. With the two major religions, so we are having so many problems because, you know, when Pope came to India in 1999, he said he is going to put a cross on India. Okay? And then the Muslims openly, they declare they are going to convert India into an Islamic country. And they want to break India into three different countries, Mughalistan, Dravidistan, Dalitistan. These are the three countries they
it's
want to make.
Extensive plan.
I mean, they are openly saying, I see, but we don't even pay attention. None of the Hindu leaders, none of the people pay attention to what they are doing, what they are saying.
You mentioned about that in your book, like Pakistan and Bangladesh.
Correct.
And it seems
correct
out there on Google and all, but...
Yeah.
Wow.
So they're openly saying it. So, but we always believe in live and let live. If you look at, so if we are having this many problems, only with these two, but not other religions, okay? Because these two religions want to expand their empires or expand their numbers and convert the India into either Christian country or Islamic country. Whereas other religions don't believe in the same thing. So they are just like us, they don't believe in conversion. So as a result, we don't have any problem with Buddhism or Shaivism.
And we are okay. That's what our history is. We have welcomed all the religions and we have allowed everybody to follow whatever their heart wants to follow.
Exactly.
And we have lived peacefully, and that's what we want. But I guess you've also mentioned in your book the recent example of Telangana.
Yes.
What's happening to temples over there. It seems they're not allowed to ring the bell in certain times in certain places. And they've openly said, it seems in Bangladesh press, that since you're a minority, it's better that you get converted.
Correct.
Now, which is something we as a nation, Indian nation, would never do. In fact, we provide more privileges to minorities.
That's exactly.
So that's a different kind of contrast. And after that, if somebody telling us intolerant is not justified. And I know you wrote like an entire page, like a whole chapter on that.
And so, if you look at Jewish people who lived in India for more than 2,000 years, and after Israel country was formed, many people moved to Israel. And one gentleman by the name Nathan Katz, he has written a book where he said, out of 126 countries Jewish people lived, India is the only country that has not discriminated the Jewish people. If we did not discriminate the Jewish people, why should we discriminate other religious people?
We are Jains, we
because,
are Buddhists.
Because, you see, Buddhist. So
Sikhs.
Dalai Lama says he is a son of Bharat. And he is proud of being a son of Bharat, because this is the only country that espouses peace.
Yes,
no other country can claim that one. So these two religions, because of their philosophy, obviously there is going to be problems which these intolerant intellectuals cannot read, cannot comprehend, they can't open up their mind, they closed their minds, they just blocked their ears, everything.
I guess intolerant intellectuals are the strength and the product of India and Hinduism. By the fact that India believes in ahimsa and believes in inclusivity, that seed is so ingrained that we will always want to include everybody. We will not demean, we will not
correct.
Respect, we will
correct.
Watch our words.
Correct, correct.
Which
correct.
Is the strength
yes.
of Hinduism.
Yes.
But at the same time, having said that, there was a time when reservations were important. There was a time when we had to provide special privileges to the minorities. But these are the times where the people who deserve are struggling. May it be education sector for whatsoever reason, and there are stories, people are getting converted just to get admissions in schools.
Correct.
May it be job sector. And all over the world, you know, their people preserve their things, may it be palaces, may it be churches, may it be castles, may it be whatever. So why should India not preserve their temples? Temples are the places of worships, of the energies and essence that Hinduism brings. There's a whole scientific way that I think Dr. Prakash Rao can explain how to build a temple and all that.
Yeah.
But why not? You know, that's what he's trying to say from this book. Let's be fair. Let's live together. And Hindus who, because it's vast, who have not maybe read enough about Hinduism, I guess he's trying to awaken them to be knowledgeable about themselves, first of all. And not that stand up and fight, but at least know who you are and still be inclusive, but at least stand up for what is right. Stand up for what is fair. I think that's what is being
yeah.
brought
yeah.
from this discussion.
Yeah. I'll just say one sentence. I think Abdul Kalam is mm-hmm. the one who mentioned that Arabs came, the British came, Mughals came, Portuguese came, all kinds of people came and conquered our country, destroyed our country, and so on and so on. And he said, we have never done this kind of atrocities to any other country. Because we respect others, we respect the freedom of others. We always give due respect for other religions and other people. We never conquered. That is one thing I think every Hindu should remember. Of course, that can be considered as a weakness, but basically it is because of the philosophy of ahimsa and tolerance. We are not part of it. In fact, we don't even think of conquering in order to propagate our religion. Our religion is a peaceful religion. It spreads based on our strengths and the principles, morals and ethics.
That is so true. A conqueror came in India and I think he was faced with a monk, one of the stories in your book. And the monk was so happy because, you know, he had nothing to lose.
Yeah.
Because what you have is in you. It's the strength in you. And a lot of different offshoots and roots and different fields of Hinduism will teach you just that. Looking inside and having strength inside.
Yeah.
And that's what Hinduism brings to the world. Having said all this, friends, let's welcome back, come back after a break. But before that, there's one more quote, which is again from his book. Let's value metric system versus mediocrity. And that applies to anything and everything. You know, if you want doctors, we want good doctors, you know, and that will be our next generation. That'll be saving our lives. And it applies to all the religions also, and all the cultures also, and all the beautiful things that India has to offer also. Every day, there are a number of languages and dialects which are actually dying down. Why not preserve them? Why not stand up for them? And why not stand up and preserve what India has to offer and has been offering since ever? So let's take a break and we shall be back after some time. This is your host, Khushbu Rawley, with Mr. Prakash Rao.